Hi everyone, my name is Joanna Behm and I am here with Christine Porcaro and we are from Messiah University. You might also see me and be familiar with me as I'm the Vice President of Dysautonomia Support Network as well. Today we just wanted to give you some information on a study that you may have participated in last year. We looked at health management strategies for individuals with POTS and so we got the results and we want to share them with you. Before we get started, I just want to tell you a little bit about us and our presentation. Our research group last year worked an entire year on this study. We started first doing a literature review where we reviewed what does the literature say about how people with POTS really, you know, manage their health and manage their symptoms. We found that there was not a lot of great information out there regarding, you know, specific techniques that they use that actually worked. And there was also not a lot out there from the patient perspective. There was a lot of information out there from a physician perspective, but we wanted to know what the patient perspective was. So I, as the research mentor and this group of four students, we worked together and studied this over the year. So we surveyed you, the members of Dysautonomia Support Network, and we have some really, really exciting results that we want to share with you.
So in this presentation, we're going to answer our research question, which was, among individuals with POTS, what health management strategies are used to impact their quality of life? So we first start by just going into some background and just figuring out, like, what is POTS? So POTS is a form of dysautonomia. So that's just a dysregulation of the autonomic nervous system. And we know that the autonomic nervous system is responsible for any type of automatic functions that go on in our body. So whether that be like our heart rate, blood pressure, digestion, and there's so many other things that the autonomic nervous system is responsible for. So in terms of some statistics, we know that approximately 500,000 to 3 million Americans are diagnosed with POTS, and the majority of those people are going to be females, ranging from ages 13 to 50. And POTS does disturb all areas of occupation. And what we mean by occupation, those are just going to be things that we want or need to do. So we have activities of daily living, which is bathing, dressing, mobility, work, education, social participation, all of those things are going to be impacted by POTS. There are a lot of different symptoms that are associated with POTS, but we do understand that the level of disability is equivalent to those with COPD or congestive heart failure. Currently, no cure does exist for POTS. However, research is showing that a combination of medications and lifestyle interventions can actually decrease some of the symptoms. So, in order to gather all of the information from this survey, we did do a descriptive survey. So, this is going to be some questions, open-ended questions, and some kind of fill in the blanks. And in terms of who participated in this study and the criteria that they had to meet, they were required to be 18 years of age or older, have a POTS diagnosis, currently experiencing symptoms that were related to POTS, and live in the United States. And there was a total of 174 individuals who did participate in this study. So in terms of the results and the demographics, we did find that the most common age groups that responded to our survey were ages 18 to 29 and 30 to 39. Majority of the people had a diagnosis for around 1 to 3 years and were primarily white. Most of them were living with others that weren't identified as a caregiver. And in terms of comorbidities, the top most common comorbidities that were experienced were hypermobility, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and also autoimmune disorders. So it was really important that we noted for the demographics was that our sample was actually representative of those that were actually diagnosed with POTS in the United States. So in terms of the results for health rating and satisfaction, you can see here that overall health rating, no one said that their health was excellent. And in terms of satisfaction with their health, no one was completely satisfied. However, the majority of our sample actually said that their overall health rating was fair. And in terms of satisfaction with their health, the majority of our sample said that they were somewhat dissatisfied. So we can actually kind of conclude from this is that current health management strategy practices are not managing their symptoms well.
So we wanted to dig deeper and really find out what were the most severe and most frequent symptoms that people with POTS were experiencing. And the most severe and frequent symptoms was fatigue, which should not surprise any of us. Out of 174 of our participants, 117 said that it was a very severe symptom and that they did experience it frequently. After that, we have brain fog, where, exercise intolerance is next, excuse me. Out of 174 participants, 91 said that exercise intolerance was a symptom that was severe and frequent. Then after that, we have sleep problems, where 72 out of 174 said that that was a severe and frequent problem. And then for brain fog, that was 58 participants said that that was severe and also it was very frequent. And then for heart palpitations or an irregular heartbeat, that was also something that was very severe and frequent. So those symptoms seem to be the most impairing overall based on how bad they are and how often they happen. So we wanted to find out what strategies were used always or often, and what strategies were also very effective or effective that people are currently using. So we asked them a whole list of strategies, which you can see here on the slide. We do have one other slide that includes more strategies. The ones that are highlighted in blue have the most responses regarding, you know, that they were used always and often and that they were very effective or effective. So we know that liberal consumption of salt and water is a strategy that a lot of people use, and they do find it, you know, 66% did find it very effective or effective. For managing dietary needs, 63% of people said that they did use that always or often, but only 54% found it very effective or effective. And then some other ones include position changes. This one is, you know, things like sitting when tired, putting your feet up, et cetera. 82% of folks said that they did use that always or often, and 70% said that it was very effective or effective. And then taking medications as prescribed also was used always or often and very effective or effective. Just to go back to show you some of the other options, we did ask about adaptive equipment, and that's things like walkers, canes, shower chairs, wheelchairs, et cetera. Behavior tracking is things like, you know, managing your symptoms by tracking what behaviors or what things you do that makes things worse or better. Compression, we're all familiar with. That is essentially trying to make sure that our blood pooling is managed using compression clothing, whether it's stockings or abdominal binders, et cetera. Communicating with health providers is just, you know, sort of keeping that open line of communication open with them regarding our symptoms. Including physical activity throughout the day. So that is, you know, making sure that we're trying to move around. Involvement in support groups that can be online or in person. Maintaining a routine seemed to be, you know, over half of the people did use it always and often, a little under half found it effective or very effective. And then meditation and mindfulness, a lot of people did not find that, did not use it that much, or also did not find it that effective. Pacing of activities at a manageable speed, that basically looks like, you know, trying to not rush things, trying not to make things take too long, making sure that you're resting and taking breaks if needed. Planning schedule of a day around symptoms. You know, when you're having poor symptoms, are you able to, you know, kind of switch things around to make it sure that your symptoms don't get worse? Regulating emotions through coping skills. So those are things like positive self-talk, making sure that you're, you know, listening to your body, listening to your emotions, and giving yourself what you need. And then structured exercise program. We differentiated, if we go back to the last slide, we differentiated between including physical activity throughout the day and exercise, because structured exercise, we mean more of a, you know, a specific program that you're following that involves maybe some, cardio type activities, as well as maybe strength training, whereas moving around throughout the day is really just keeping your body moving and not just sitting, you know, all day. So when we look at these, we found that the most effective health management strategies were these five. So taking medications as prescribed, prioritizing daily tasks based on fatigue. And with that, it really looks at, you know, is this thing important? Can I delegate it to somebody else? Can I do it at a different time? Can I, choose to not do it? Or is it something that I have to push through, right? So kind of prioritizing based on your current level of fatigue. Of course, position changes, making sure that you're sitting when you need to, you can put your feet up and that you're listening to your body. Liberal consumption of salt and waters, making sure that we stay hydrated and that we do consume salt to help with our blood volume. And then managing dietary needs. A lot of us have, current dietary needs that are maybe separate from POTS, or maybe diet really helps, you know, people control their POTS. So those five were the most effective and used most frequently strategies that we found. So something interesting then that we found was, okay, when they're not using the methods, what is their quality of life? And you can see that on the right-hand side. And when they are using those methods, what is their quality of life? So you can see here between excellent, you know, less than 1% said excellent when not using it, and 5 said excellent when using it. Again, less than a 1% said good when not using it, 35% said good when using them. And this is really interesting, 45% said fair when using our methods, and 16% said when not using methods. And then this one's really interesting. If they're not using their methods, the majority of people said that it was poor or very poor, right? So we have 40% for poor, 43% for very poor. Whereas when we are using methods, the highest percentages were fair and good. So it goes to show that it's not that it makes our health excellent or, you know, makes, you know, it doesn't cure us by any means. But when we're using some of these methods, the participants found that their overall quality of life went from the majority poor, very poor, to majority fair and good, which we thought was a really interesting finding. The last thing in regards to new results that we found was in regards to adaptive equipment. So we asked people what adaptive equipment they used. And if you can see here, this blue, it involved a shower chair. And we found that 43.7% of people found shower chairs to be that they used. A rollator, cane, walker, crutches, 23% said that they used those. 17.8% of people said that they used a wheelchair or a power chair. 8% of people said they used compression. That finding was really interesting to us because we know that most doctors do prescribe compression, but as somebody who also has POTS, I realize how uncomfortable compression can be. So we think that may be why we got that response. 7% said that they use braces or orthotics. 7% said that they use a chair or a stool. 6% said that they use a reacher. And about 6% said that they use a grab bar and a rail. So the most frequently used piece of adaptive equipment was the shower chair, as well as the, a cane, a walker, or a rollator, or crutches. So the results of our survey really supported the claim that current health management strategies are not really managing POTS symptoms super well. And we know that because of the rating of satisfaction with overall health and well-being. Their low satisfaction levels may come from even if they have a high rate of adherence to their routines and their medication management. So that kind of suggests that we need additional strategies outside of our medications. What we found is that outside of medication, the five most frequently used symptom management strategies included lifestyle modifications. The frequent use and reported effectiveness of these health strategies compared to not using them suggests that people diagnosed with POTS would benefit from really implementing some of these lifestyle modifications that we talked about into their routines. Participants did find that adaptive equipment is effective. 64.8% of our participants rated that the use of adaptive equipment as very effective or effective. However, only 43.7% of participants reported using it always or often. So those who did use it did find it effective, but not everyone did use it. So we may want to consider potentially using adaptive equipment in their life. And the last thing that we want to point out is occupational therapists, we're experts in lifestyle modification, and we can be consulted to address symptom management strategies for those with POTS. So I encourage you, if this is sounding like something that you might benefit from, please ask your provider to provide an occupational therapy referral, and they can sort of walk you through best ways to manage your symptoms outside of medication. So we just want to thank you so much for your time and for watching this. Christine and I are just really proud of this work that we've done. So if you have other questions or comments, please feel free to reach out. My email is here, jbeam@messiah.edu. And we look forward to potentially hearing from you. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.